Welcome everybody, this is Mr. Fugu, and you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're exploring and cleaning some online sales data using RStudio. This would be a multi-part series for a project that you can create. The code will be provided in the link in the description below. The outcome today will be cleaning the data, doing feature extraction, look for duplicate rows, remove them, look for NA values, remove those, also show what rows have NA values, do a technique similar to Python's value count, look for unique values from specific columns, and inspect our data. Remember, as always, please subscribe and turn on that notification bell and throw me a like. If you don't like the video, throw me a comment and tell me why before you dislike. You're going to need Knitter, Tidyverse, and I don't think we're going to need TidyR today. This data set will be provided in the description below, as well as the Jupyter Notebook. We have almost 541,000 rows with 8 columns, which are your invoice number, the stock number, a description of the item, the quantity sold, the data was sold, the price per item, the unique customer ID, as well as the country that made the purchase. If you're looking to find duplicate values, you just say duplicated and then parentheses and whatever you're calling. Here, I wanted to find the number of duplicated rows. It turns out that we have 5268. Now, how does that affect the total data set? Well, it turns out that it's minuscule and it's less than 1%. We retained a little over 99% of our original data after we got rid of the duplicated rows. Okay, that's fine. Now, what does it look like if we actually print that out? So you say, let's call our data frame, use the square brackets, then we say, let's take all the rows that are duplicated, and then find all columns. Okay? That's what's going on after this comma. So we print that out, and this is what it looks like. Okay? Well, now, I say, here's what our duplicated rows look like. That's fine and dandy. We could, you know, use that. We could just do it for no reason. Who cares? But you can also do a logical not if you would like to get rid of duplicated rows and only show everything else. And that's what's going on here. So I say, let's take our online retail data frame. Let's use our brackets. It's called the logical not operator for the duplicated rows and return over all the columns. So here we are. This is everything except the duplicated values. This is what we want. Okay, cool. So we got two ways of doing this then, huh? Yep, we have another one where we're removing duplicates, but we're using the dplyr method. So you're calling your data, then you're using the percent, greater sign, percent, and you're calling distinct here. So you're basically finding all the distinct or unique values in your data. And that's what's going on here, and you're getting rid of it. So now you have two different ways to do it. Now, what is the proportion of data that actually has NA values? Well, if you're trying to find an NA value, you say is.NA, and then parentheses, and whatever your data is you're calling here. It turns out, in our case, 25% of our data that we just made, which does not have duplicates, was occupied by NA values. Well then, what about if we wanted to look and find all the places that this occurred with the columns that it occurred in? Well, you can use an apply method, which is awesome because there's a family of apply functions, and they're really unique because it helps you avoid using iteration in R. So you say, Let's use our apply function where we're finding all of our NA values here, and we're using 2 because we're looking at the columns. Then, if we used 1, it's row-wise, and then we use which, so we're saying which places have our NA values. And then if you were looking at a new function and you never used it before, or you just couldn't remember what are all the features, you just do a question mark and then the function name, and then it prints out here, apply function over array margins, and then it tells you how you set it up, explains what everything is in detail, and gives you some examples. And this is really useful because it'll help you, you know, on the fly figure things out, and you may not have to go to Stack Overflow immediately. You might be able to just figure it out initially. Then we could do something similar to a union, where we're taking our data right here, and we're using our dplyr type of notation, but now we're using something new. So we're saying, let's filter all, and let's take any variable that has an NA value. And this right here is just a predicate. You know, it's that dot is called a predicate. And so you're just saying, let's take this verb and let's find a predicate. Now, this is printing out all the rows that have NA values. And you say, oh, wow, this description would be useless. There's nothing here. And this column, well, let's just get rid of this ID, customer ID column. Well, there's two things going on here. One, if you're looking at the behavior of customers, individual customers, you need to take this into account. Therefore, you cannot use any rows that do not have a customer ID. But if you are looking at the macro version and only the behavior of country data, and if all of your entries have a country name, but it didn't have a customer, who cares? Because then you could look directly at countrywide behavior of purchasing and do a comparison of those. Now, how do you get rid of this NA value? Well, we can do an NA.omit, and that removes all of our NA values. Well, that's pretty simple. Well, how much of our data is actually, our subset data is actually taken care of now? You know, because it seems like it's a pretty big amount of our data. It looks like it's 25% of our original data. All right, but we're not using our original data here. We're using the subset data without the duplicates. Oh, it's still 25%. Okay, so that's still pretty high. Now, how do we want to do with that? Well, it depends on what you're doing for your analysis. Now, what if you're looking for unique values? Well, you just run the unique and then your column name. And for instance here, we're just looking at the unique country names. But if you're looking now at finding like a value count similar to the Python method, you would do what's called table and then the color name that you're looking for. Here, we're finding the specific customer made 2 purchases over the year time span that we have for the data. This customer made 182 unique purchases. Okay? So that's really useful. Then we could find how many, we could subset our data and find out basically how many unique values are for each one of these columns. So I said, let's find out the customers, the invoices, like the amount of transactions, and the unique products. And we noticed that we have a little over 4,000 unique customers, and of those customers, they made 22,190 transactions. And of those transactions, there were unique products in the amount of 3,684. Okay, cool. Well, then let's do some sorting. And how do you do sorting? Let's sort our data and call it order, which we'll do in ascending order here, if you notice, by the country. And then we're doing it by description also. So we're ordering by two different columns here and printing it off. So first we have it by country, then ordering by description of item. Okay, fine. Well, then sometimes when you're doing analysis of your data, there's things that you don't pay attention to and can affect you later on down the road. This happened to me when I did this project a few years ago, and I didn't catch this. If you notice here, there's a C, and that C is talking about a cancellation of an item or a transaction. So then you say, here's my original invoice number, which is made at this time, with a quantity of one of these things purchased. But then, you know, more than an hour later, you said, oh no, I don't want this anymore, and you cancel that off. And that will mess up your analysis. So sometimes you have to further investigate your data to see if there's anything going on. And so then I say, well, then how do I deal with these canceled values? Well, one way you can deal with it is using grep. And I could say, grep, let's find everything that starts with a C or has a C in it in the invoice column. And let's print that out as a data frame. And here we go. We're printing that out as a data frame. But how much of our data was actually occupied by this? And it turns out that we have, you know, almost 16.5% of our data, our subset data, occupied by canceled orders. Well, that causes a problem because now you have to track down this order that was canceled and the original purchase order and basically get rid of those rows because you can't use that data. Then you have another issue. If you were to look at, let me make sure I verify this correctly. Okay. Let me just make sure. So 54, 14. Oh, I need 13. Okay, so if you're looking at this, you'd say, well, if I made the table and I look just at the invoice number for this specific invoice, for the specific purchase or transaction, what comes out? And I say, oh, well, 28 equals true. What does that 28 mean? Well, that doesn't mean the quantity of 28 things purchased. That means that we have 28 individual rows where there were different items that were purchased in different quantities. So you got to pay attention to that. And there are 27 unique items because one of these was purchased two times back to back in the same order. They just increased the quantities. I can't remember which one. But you got to pay attention to that. Now, you also have this. So let's say we sort by the customer ID number, okay? We sort by the customer ID, which is fine. And what was this person's customer ID? 13859. So, I'd have to go in here. We'd have to extract it out. Okay. So, if you're looking in here, you could have some. You could have some issues too if you're not paying attention. Okay? Here is where we have our hiccups that we have to adjust for later. And you have to get a little creative on how you set this up. Now, we're not going to do that in this circumstance, but I'd like to make you aware of that. We'll be moving on to further analysis in this in the coming videos. I think that the next video I will do will be another database video, since I'm getting a lot of replies to MongoDB using R and Python. So I may do a few more videos of that, and I'll come back to this in a few days. But by the end of this project, what we plan on doing is doing some PCA using a few statistical techniques and diving further into this data and figure out what's really going on so we get some clear insight and do some plotting. But as always, I'd like to say thank you for watching this video. I hope it brought you some, brought somebody some utility. Please subscribe and like the video. And again, if you don't like the video, leave me a comment before you throw a thumbs down. Have a good one. See you in the next video.